Simon & Schuster Audio presents Her Last Death, a Memoir by Susanna Sonnenberg. Read by the author.
This is a work of memoir and subject to the imperfections of memory. I have been faithful to what I remember, and people in my family may remember shared experiences differently. In the interest of the narrative, I have conflated or changed some events and dialogue and created occasional composites. I have changed some identifying characteristics and have reconstructed some conversations and early experiences based on family lore. I have changed all names but my own to emphasize that this story could only be mine. Her Last Death. The phone shouldn't ring this early. When I answer, my Aunt Irene rushes into the news. Your mother's been in an accident. She's been in surgery all night. She's probably going to die. This can't be true, of course. I'm waiting for the story. Irene will laugh her exasperated laugh and say my mother used to date the surgeon, or she's already secured a better hospital room. But Irene says my mother's in a coma, and when she finishes that sentence, I stop moving around the kitchen and sit. She usually calls her sister Daphne, but she keeps saying, your mother. My mother had a head-on collision after a dinner party. I want to ask if she was sober. Irene probably asked the same question of the person who called to tell her. The police have a record this time, she says. The hospital has a chart. The adrenaline of true emergency goes through me and I draw a blank. I keep thinking, my mother had an accident. But the thought has nowhere to settle and stick. Susie, my aunt says, she's worried for me. If I speak, I'll say, do I have to go? So I mustn't open my mouth. I try to think what other people say in this situation. I'm afraid my mother will die. I'm afraid she won't. In a house in Montana, thousands of miles from my mother, I am 37, leading an unremarkable life. My mother lives in Barbados, where she stayed after her third husband died. I've never seen her house. She plays tennis and has house guests, I hear, but we don't speak. Instead, I concentrate on the organic granola my two boys like, the seascape mural I'm about to paint on their bedroom wall. I preside over their school board and review movies for the paper. I send the photos of Halloween costumes and birthday parties to my father and stepmother. Last night, like most nights, my husband and I read books to each of the boys, crossing back and forth between their beds, with kisses for them and patient hugs for their stuffed animals. This morning, my husband will pack the lunch for our 6-year-old, and I'll play with the 2-year-old until his nap. We've just purchased this 100-year-old house. On moving day, I realize we would never invite my mother to see it. We live in sunny rooms messy with socks and books, a bathroom scattered with tub toys that are always drying, never dry. Christopher and I wonder before sleep at our boys' happiness and their invisible trust. Sometimes I'm jealous of them. Over the years, my Aunt Irene and I have wearied together of the stories that start, guess what Daphne did? I tell a couple of them myself, rarely now, but sometimes at a dinner party. My mother gave me cocaine. You wouldn't believe what she said to my new boyfriend. She had an affair with a mobster. These aren't stories I tell my children. The boys' voices topple down the stairs before they come into the kitchen. I'll need to hang up when they start to tug at me with their small demands. Irene says my grandmother, also in Barbados, has not gone yet to the hospital. She's hopeless, a complete wreck. I should ask for the hospital's number, but say, let's talk later, and hang up the phone. I tell Christopher enough to give him a sense of the news and go to another room to call my sister. What she knows will be different from our aunt's story. This is how we move forward in my family, calling one another in almost every configuration 5 people can make. One woman gets a call, puts down the phone, picks it up again, repeats the story, hears another version. We fold in the new details that are not yet our own and patch together pieces until a certain sense emerges. My younger sister and I have an uneasy truce on the subject of our mother. We don't want to fight, so we don't mention her. When Penelope answers, she sounds like she's drowning. "Oh, sweetie," I say, until she can stop sobbing and tell me what she's heard. Newly married, lucky with fun jobs that flame out fast, Penelope lives in the New York apartment where we grew up, subletting from our mother. She doesn't seem to mind being buoyed by the swells of Daphne's manic behavior. When our mother comes to the city, Penelope gives her pink sheets in the room that used to be ours and carries the paper in to her in the mornings. Penelope's report matches Irene's. "I've got the first flight out in the morning. What about you?" she says, inflection absent. "I've got to figure out the kids," I say. "I'll call her back." Christopher's mother could stay with the boys. He says, "Just let me know what you need. I'll do it." I'll need him to come with me, but what else? What else do I need? I go online, look into fares. All the flights are full, the cost enormous. I'm not sure I can do anything, my travel agent warns. I'm off the hook, relieved, but there's also the part of me that longs for my mother in moments like these, her gall and grandeur. In the airports of my childhood, she'd say, "Girls, you sit down over there," and she'd straighten her fitted suede jacket, align the silk scarf at her throat, and ease her way to the front of the first-class line for an overbooked flight. "Don't worry," I'd tell Penelope, holding her hand. "She'll get us on." I could pick out our mother's laugh above the other voices, then her confidential murmur as she made a gift of her attention to the clerk behind the counter. People, men especially, liked doing things she wanted, couldn't help themselves. She made them feel they'd be important to her. Her well-cut hair flowed past her shoulders, and she lined her eyes with kohl. She had elegant arched eyebrows. She wore platform heels, even with her bad back, and sheer blouses fastened in a V between her breasts. Sometimes people thought she was our babysitter, a sophisticated, pretty teenager. She'd brandish her knockout smile and say, "No, I'm the mummy." She knew wit made her sharp features softer, and she was funny, agile with an anecdote or a naughty observation. When she beckoned, we got up and went over, and the clerk would say, "I'm sorry about your grandmother," or, "I hope your daddy will be okay." We knew to fall into the act long enough to make it to those first-class seats. When we went out together, my mother made us the stars and the champions. She tossed off rapid, irreverent remarks, urged indulgence out of the most recalcitrant of salesgirls, seduced the most unhavable of men. She spent money with fuck you abandon. To walk into a deli with her and order a sandwich was a particular commitment, a willingness to let her own the day. I've lived apart from my mother since I left for boarding school at 14. I called home often then, pressing her voice to my ear, our mutual interest insatiable. She called me from restaurant cloakrooms and lovers' beds, ready to start new rumors. She called from hospitals after back surgery. She phoned from airports, dinner parties, and the lobbies of movie theaters in which she stood weeping over a love story. She needed me, she said, to calm her down. Her sexual allure extended from bartenders and cab drivers to rock stars, football heroes, and anchormen. "He calls me whenever he's in town," she told me of an actor, whose name was bigger than any movie he'd starred in. I was 11, precocious with contempt, and said, "That's too much. I don't believe you." She had him call me that afternoon from his hotel suite while she was there.
"Your mother says you don't believe her, Susie."
It was obviously him, his famous seduction in each slow syllable.
"Susie, you should always believe your mother."
I had to admit that now I believed her. One night the following year, touring boarding schools, we took a Cosmo quiz together. We traded the magazine between the motel beds, circling multiple-choice answers on pleasure and technique. She used a pen and I used a pencil so we could tell our answers apart. As I tallied our scores, she was restless, up and down, over to the dresser where she had cocaine set out. "That admissions guy was cute, didn't I think?" She wiped at her gums in the mirror. "This is weird," I said, nervous. I tried to ignore the tiny smug feeling. "How'd I do?" She bounced onto her bed. It was there in the numbers. Her score meant she was a shrinking violet, but I'd aced the test. The magazine called me, the eighth grader, desperate for a first French kiss.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.